Welcome to worship. We gather together, as always, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Just as a note for this evening's worship service, we are going to be celebrating communion here tonight. And so here for the next few moments, if you would like to go and make sure you're ready with a piece of bread or a cracker, a glass of grape juice or wine, and come back ready to share in communion later on in the service, that would be excellent. We're so glad that you've chosen to join us here tonight for worship. And to bring us into worship here this evening, I'd like to welcome here the messengers with Mighty to Save. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the keeper of the covenant, the source of steadfast love, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. God hears us when we cry and draws us close in Jesus Christ. Let us return to the one who is full of compassion. Fountain of living water, pour out your mercy over us. Our sin is heavy, and we long to be free. Rebuild what we have ruined and mend what we have torn. Wash us in your cleansing flood. Make us alive in the Spirit to follow in the way of Jesus as healers and restorers of the world you so love. Amen. Beloved, God's word never fails. The promise rests on grace. By the saving love of Jesus Christ, the wisdom and power of God, your sins are forgiven, and God remembers them no more. Journey in the way of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Together we pray. O God, with steadfast love, you draw us to yourself, and in mercy you receive our prayers. Strengthen us to bring forth the fruits of the Spirit, that through life and death we may live in your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The first reading is from Jeremiah 31, 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from Hebrews 5, verses 5 through 10. Christ did not glorify himself in becoming a high priest, but was appointed by the one who said to him, "You are my son. Today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death. And he was heard because of his reverent submission. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And having been made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him, having been designated by God a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Our gospel reading today is from the Gospel of John, chapter 12, verses 20 to 33. Now among those who went up to worship at the festival were some Greeks. They came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida in Galilee, and said to him, "Sir, we wish to see Jesus." Philip went and told Andrew. Then Andrew and Philip went and told Jesus. Jesus answered them, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Very truly I tell you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains just a single grain. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. Those who love their life lose it, and those who hate their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Whoever serves me must follow me, and where I am, there will my servant be also. Whoever serves me, the Father will honor. Now my soul is troubled, and what should I say? Father, save me from this hour? No, it is for this reason that I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name." Then a voice came from heaven, "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again." The crowd standing there heard it and said that it was thunder. Others said, "An angel has spoken to him." Jesus answered, "This voice has come for your sake, not for mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be driven out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." He said this to indicate the kind of death he was to die. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. It's been really interesting to me of late, the way that I see God at work in the world around me. As I was preparing to write my sermon by reading the text for this week, I started to think about all of the conversations I have had over the past few days and the things that I have read. It is strange, the winding road that God sometimes leads us on to reveal to us the work that God is doing in our own lives, as well as in the lives of others, and how it all ties back to the story of God's people. Our gospel reading this week from the Gospel of John is the final teaching in what is known as Jesus' public ministry. This is the final time in this gospel that Jesus will teach anyone outside of his group of disciples and followers. Jesus responds to the arrival of the Greeks, who represent the entire world coming to see Jesus, by saying that the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. The time has come, the time is here for the work that God has set out for Jesus. That is, his torture, death, and resurrection. That time has come really got my mind moving in a very Lutheran loop, in the already but not yet that we talk often about. Christ has already died, he is already risen. And yet we continue to wait for the not yet, the Christ will come again part. One of my teachers at Luther Seminary, Matt Skinner, during this week's Sermon Brainwave podcast, asked, what does it mean that my, or the world's judgment, is behind us? Even though Christ has not yet come, with that judgment behind us, what does that mean for us? When we think about the things that Christ's death and resurrection have done for us, the things that come to mind for me are the forgiveness of sins, the fulfillment of the law, and the great compassion and the steadfast love of God incarnated for us in the person of Jesus Christ. And here is where the first connection to my week comes in. I've been meeting with a congregation member one-on-one over the past couple of weeks to be a listening ear as she prepares a Bible study for a group of women here at St. John's. The book this group is reading is by Walter Brueggemann called The Psalms and the Life of Faith. It's a pretty dense read, but in our reading about Psalm 77, there were two sentences that came to mind when I was thinking about our gospel reading for today. In speaking about Psalm 77, verse 11, Brueggemann says, the move in this verse, or the switch from what was talked about before and what's talked about after, is a move from a religion of law to a religion of grace. It articulates the awareness that we live by gift and not by grasp. That's a pretty powerful statement. We live by gift and not by grasp. In the already of Christ's death and resurrection, in the already of the ruler of this world being driven out, the lives we live are a gift. In the same podcast, Caroline Lewis asked the question, specifically in regards to Jesus' followers, but I think it applies to us as well. How are we going to respond? How are our lives going to be a reflection of the gift we have been given? Brueggemann's reflection on Psalm 77, verse 11, compares the move of this verse to the one in Gospel of Mark, chapter 8, verse 35. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and the sake of the gospel will save it. While not exactly the same, this statement by Jesus in Mark is reflected in Jesus' words in John chapter 12, verse 25. What Jesus puts in front of us with this statement is what our response will lead to. On one hand, we can hold tight to the things that serve us alone, or we can turn to the call of the Spirit and the gift of grace, an imaginative leap of faith that sees the reality of the kingdom here and now. Circling back to the already but not yet, if the kingdom of God is right now, how do we explain the things around us? The Jeremiah text for today says the Lord, I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, know the Lord, for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest. To this, I will echo another question from the Sermon Brainwave podcast. What does this mean, since it hasn't happened yet? We're still preaching and teaching. Not everyone knows God, or at least not in a way that reminds them that they are a beloved child of God. This all gets back to the already, but not yet, and the waiting. The reason we have the gospel stories and the letters of Paul is because the not yet of Christ's return is real. We are still here, and we are still waiting. The Apostle Paul spent much of his time not just proclaiming the gospel message, but also teaching people how to live in the not yet time between Christ's resurrection and his return, the waiting. And if we as people know nothing else after the past year, we now know what it truly means to wait. We have the smallest glimpse of what it must have felt like for those who had been with Jesus in the flesh to wait for his return. But despite the waiting, the Spirit's ongoing work is still happening. Our work as people of God is not to somehow bring about forgiveness and salvation, as that is the already part, nor is it our work to bring about the not yet. But rather, our work is to allow our imaginations to be open to the work of the Spirit, to take that gift that we've been given of God's grace and steadfast love, and imagine together what the future might look like. Joy J. Moore asks in the same podcast, what can our community do in our living that points to the day yet to come? In this question, I came full circle to the study and conversations with our 7th and 8th graders around mental health that we've been doing for the last 5 weeks on a curriculum called Faith in an Anxious World. This past week, our lesson revolved around the gospel story of Luke, chapter 8, verses 40 to 56. It's the story of the woman who'd been bleeding for 12 years and the synagogue official's daughter who was dying. The two stories show us people who had no control over what was happening to them. They were in hopeless situations. The woman who had been bleeding had done everything she could to help herself, and the father of the little girl was desperately seeking out Jesus. Everyone around them was pushing them aside or telling them not to bother Jesus. But he stops in his tracks. Wherever he's going, it's not as important as the people in front of him. He's not too busy to stop and notice the woman no one else seemed to have time for. He doesn't even overlook the girl everyone else had given up for dead. Of the many things that the study that I've been working on with the students can be observed in this passage, this is the important one to take away. No matter how old a person is, no matter how hopeless things seem, no matter what everyone else thinks, when we're hurting, we're Jesus's top priority. Each and every one of us is Jesus's top priority. We all matter. Jesus says in John chapter 12, verse 32, "And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself, not just some, all." With that in mind, what can our community do in our living, not just in our words, that points to the day yet to come, the day when Christ returns and waiting will finally be at an end? I would lift up what Walter Brueggemann says about Psalm 77, verse 10. Everything prior to that verse is about the I. Everything after it is about the thou, that is, God, the Most High. Everything about verse 10 is up for grabs. Perhaps where the world is now is similar. Does the community of faith stay centered inward, or do we take a huge leap of faith, following the Spirit to a place where what we uphold is not our own needs, but rather that the no matter how old a person is, no matter how hopeless things seem, no matter what everyone else thinks, when we're hurting, we're Jesus's top priority. All of us. No matter what. Amen.
I keep finding voices. voices in my mind that say I'm not enough. Every single lie that tells me I will never measure up. Am I more than just the sum of every high and every low? Remind me once again just who I am, because I need to know. Ooh, oh, you say I am loved when I can't feel a thing. You say I am strong when I think I am weak. You say I am held when I am falling short. And when I don't belong, oh, you say
We confess our faith together through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Relying on the promises of God, we pray boldly for the church, the world, and all in need. Wash us through and through and remember our sin no more. Make your church a community of forgiveness throughout the world. Give your people courage to forgive. Through them, show the world new possibilities. Bless ministries of repentance and reconciliation. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You promise to write your law on our hearts. Guide citizens throughout the world to shape communities that reflect your mercy, justice, and peace, and give them creativity to work for the welfare of all. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. You sustain us with your bountiful spirit. Restore the joy of all who need to know your presence. Those who are lonely or feel unforgivable. Those who need healing of mind or body, those who are dying, and all who grieve. This evening, we uplift prayers for Arletta, for Anne, for Susie, for Mark, and for those who weigh heavily on our hearts and minds at this time. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. Jesus calls us to follow him in life and death. Empower this congregation in discipleship. Equip children and teachers in Sunday school, confirmation, and learning ministries. Give us your truth and wisdom and teach us to follow Jesus. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. In the cross of Christ, your name is glorified. We praise you for those who have given us words to worship you. With all those who have died in Christ, bring us into everlasting life. This evening, we pray especially for those families who have lost those recently, loved ones, friends, those who are dear. This evening, we uplift the family of Elaine Rood, Bob Pike, and Augie Eggert. Continue to be with them, show them your comfort and your love. Surround them with your voice made flesh. Surround them with those who love them. Hear us, O God. Your mercy is great. We entrust ourselves and all our prayers to you, O faithful God, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Redeemed, take your place beside the Savior. lyres and these leaves, there's no one unwelcome here. That sin and shame that you brought with you, you can leave it at the door. Let mercy draw you near. Come to the table. Come join the sinners who have been redeemed. Take your place beside the Savior. Sit down and be set free. Come to the
the hero and the coward, to the prisoner and the soldier, to the young and to the older, all who hunger, all who thirst, all the last and all the first, all the paupers and the princess, all who fail, you've been forgiven, all who dream and all who suffer, all who've loved and lost another, all the chains and all the free, all who follow, all who
On our way to the table this evening, we give thanks for the offering we have received. Together we pray, faithful God, you walk beside us in desert places, and you meet us in our hunger with bread from heaven. Accompany us in this meal, that we may pass over from death to life with Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. So, somebody asked a question here this past week about how you do communion online. They said, Pastor, I kind of forget when I'm supposed to eat the bread and drink the wine because you talk about the words of institution and you say in the night in which he was betrayed, and I think I'm supposed to eat the bread then and I'm supposed to drink. It's okay if you do that, by the way. But the way that this sets up for communion for us is this. We get a chance to say thanks. That's why we start this off with the Great Thanksgiving. We say the words of institution as a way for us to remember the story, to put ourselves in the story, to remember and heed Jesus' words, to remember in the flesh, in our bodies. Then we get a chance to pray the Lord's Prayer, where we go to God and we ask for everything we need, including that daily bread. And then we have an invitation to the table. And only then can we take the bread and the wine. But like I said, there's grace for you even if you eat the bread and drink the wine early. So there we go. We've had a little liturgical lesson this evening. And with that, we make our way here to this table. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to his disciples to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." In Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So here, from the table in our house to the table in yours, we will be serving you here at this time. Jesus draws the whole world to himself. Come to this meal and be fed. This is the body of Christ given for you. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. The body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. God of steadfast love, at this table you gather your people into one body for the sake of the world. Send us in the power of your Spirit that our lives bear witness to the love that has made us new in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. So I have just one big announcement for tonight. If you haven't heard yet, check your emails, look in your mailboxes. You should have gotten something from us by now, but just in case you haven't checked your mail yet today, go check it. We are going to be returning back to the building here this coming Sunday, March 28th, Palm Sunday, for in-person, in-house worship. It's coming. The services are going to be at 8:30 a.m., service in the building here. At 9:15, we're going to have our Zoom service. At 10 o'clock is faith formation. And then at 11:30, we're going to have our second in-house, in-person worship service. 8:30 in person, 9:15 Zoom, 10 o'clock faith formation, 11:30 in person, in-house. We are asking that you please go and register if you're planning on coming to attend a service in-house. We would like to make sure we know who's going to be here and also to help us make sure that we're not going to overpack the room. And so you can do all of this. You can find out all this information along with the fact that we need volunteers. We still need your help. The only way that this is going to happen for us is if you are if you're willing to come and join us in the building. If you're willing to come, then please join us in helping to make the service happen. You can find out all the information about this that you need in your email, or you can go to stjohnscasson.org/worship, and you can find all of the information, how to register, what time the services are, how to sign up for volunteer, and we have some training sessions coming up if you're not sure what it means to be a volunteer. All of that's on there, stjohnscasson.org/worship. We're so excited about being able to come back into the building together to share some holy space, and we look forward to just seeing you in person here in just a few short days. What'd I forget? Oh, yeah. So what Rayelle would like me to tell you is that if you don't like to use the internet, even though you're joining us here tonight, you can call into the office, and we will help get you registered for worship. And I see a hand waving from Michelle.
Yes, thank you. This is Michelle. I would like to remind everybody that the last training session is at 1 o'clock on Saturday. All you got to do is show up at church. Don't even worry about signing up. Come to church, go to the fellowship hall, and I'll show you what it means to be a volunteer during the COVID season. And one final thing. Easter is the busiest season of the year for our ministerial staff. And we have two funerals and one critically ill patient in our congregation. And our staff are really worried about getting back together in-person worship. Please send up your prayers for our staff. They need a little uplifting because they're working their butts off right now.
Oh, thanks, Michelle. And we appreciate that. Yes. So and if you wanted to know, that was Michelle Coy, who's off camera right here. So thank you for that. And thank you for asking for the prayers as well for all of us. We appreciate that. And before I forget, many thanks to the messengers tonight, to Ann and Jim Trihey, Joel Mindermann, Wes Evans, Michelle Coy, Sam Marsland, and then up in the balcony making sure that we can have worship tonight. We've got Rayelle Haase and Dennis and Patty Foster. Thank you so much for being here, everybody, and sharing your gifts, making this space a possibility for us. And with that, I'm going to offer this blessing. You are what God made you to be, created in Christ Jesus for good works, chosen as holy and beloved, freed to serve your neighbor. God bless you, that you may be a blessing in the name of the holy and life-giving Trinity, and all God's children said, Amen. Amen.
Share the good news. Thanks be to God.